All right, hi guys. I want to talk to you about promises and generators in Node. I actually wanted to talk to you about ES6 and the features in general. But just the generators alone probably can take up to 30 minutes, so I thought we just talk about that for now, get a little into that. And promises and generators together can be really powerful, and I want to show you a few things you can do with it, and one pattern in particular that I really enjoy using. I myself mostly build APIs with Node for something or another. And the first time I heard about callback hell was probably after using Node for a year or two. It was never really an issue to me, and I thought it's kind of complaining, like, hello world is too complicated in JavaScript. It can be if you choose to. That actually works, it's valid JavaScript. But there was another issue that I had with callbacks. You all probably saw this piece of code. You've probably all written it. Some of you maybe have a keyboard shortcut for it. and that got quite annoying, and promises really could help with that as well. And finally, we have native promises in Node, which is awesome. And the basic syntax looks like this pretty much. So you're probably familiar with it if you have used any kind of library. The difference you might see is a catch. Usually you might use a fail or whatever. But that's the basic syntax, and I thought I'd use the read file method as an example because it's something everybody uses at some point, and it's in the core API. We don't need any library for it, it just works. There's just one small problem, and that is it doesn't work. Because Node core API doesn't support promises, it doesn't return promises. While we do have promises natively in Node, all the core API calls return a callback, they don't return a promise. And there are more or less good reasons for it. You can find the discussion on GitHub if you're interested. The two main reasons that I've got out of it are pretty much backwards compatibility, so you don't want to break stuff just because you remove the callback and start returning promising. And the second bit is we want Node core to stay lean and not get too bloated. So having both in there would be unnecessary, really. So those are pretty much the main reasons. And whether they change it at some point or not is open, but it doesn't look like it. So just something to be aware of. It's not a big deal or anything. Yeah, just be aware of that. So yeah, let's go through how it actually looks like. It's pretty straightforward. You just have a promise class, a promise keyword. You use the new keyword like you would with any other class to instantiate a new promise. And funnily enough, you give this promise a function. So essentially, a promise works on a callback, technically. So it just builds on top of this technology. So you give this new promise a method, and this method takes two parameters, which are by convention resolve and reject. Which on its own are essentially just callbacks. And you do whatever you want to do, and then call either resolve or reject, depending on what you want to do, whether it was successful what you did or there was an error. And then if you want to use your promise you created, you just go on like we showed before with then and catch. So if we go back to our example of a read file, we could do something like so. Just create a new promise, do our read file thing, and the callback, depending on whether we have an error or not, we call resolve or reject. So pretty straightforward, but you probably don't want to actually do that. Promises are super awesome, but if you start doing it yourself like this, you just add more work than you get value out of it, in my opinion. but again, there are libraries that can promisefy everything for you if you really wanted to. But yeah, the general idea how you can use promises is pretty much like so, and then you can do whatever you want with it. So what else we can do with promises? Pretty much the same as with all the libraries as well. So the most obvious is you can chain them. So when you return a promise in your then method, you can just go on and on and on. And that is the main thing how you get out of the so-called callback hell. You can just chain promises on and build upon them. This example is a little silly, but if we had a file, and in this file, there would be some text or pass to another file. We could take this, it would return, and then could read that file as well and build upon the result we got before. So that the chaining thing is probably the main thing you want to do with promises, really. The other thing is promise.all. You have probably the same stuff in all the other libraries as well. And basically what it does is you give it an array of promises, and it runs all promises simultaneously. And once they are all done, you go into your then and can do stuff with the results. Or if any one of those promises failed, you go straight to catch and ignore all the other results. So if you do promise all, just be aware that as soon as just one of those fails, you completely ignore all the results and go straight to the catch. Usually you want that because you need all to work out. Just need to be aware of that. And then we have race, which is pretty much exactly what it sounds like. You again give it an array of promises, and whichever promise returns something first gets resolved or rejected. You can use that, for example, to run the same kind of promise against two different systems to just see which one is faster and use that. Just be aware, the first one that rejects again goes straight to catch and you ignore the other one. So if you had one that fails before the other one resolves, you still go straight to catch and ignore the other one. So be aware of that. If you have something that fails very quickly, you might not want to use that, or make sure that you really want to fail in that case. So that's pretty much all the kind of stuff you can with native promises. So it works very similar to what you have used before, most likely. It's nothing too crazy. But natively, so that's great. So a generator. Generators are really fun stuff, weird stuff. It probably takes some time to get really around that concept, what it means. And basically, a generator is just a function that you can pause and then jump back into at another time. And that probably doesn't make too much sense for you, so we'll just go through some examples and see what it actually means. The basic syntax is just like so. The two things you will notice is a funny star. If you put a star in front of the method name, it's a generator, and that's just the syntax. If you come from any other language, you probably know the star for stuff like pointers and so on. Obviously, we use it for something entirely different. It has nothing to do with that. So if you know it from different languages, ignore it. We are JavaScript. We do our stuff how we want it. The other keyword is yield. Yield is essentially the keyword where you then pause and jump back into it. How that actually looks like in practice, I'll show you later on again. Just keep it in mind. Yield is essentially the keyword you need to make use of a generator. And that's pretty much all there is to it. Now, how we would actually use a generator would be like so. So you create an instance of your generator. Keep in mind without the new keyword, because again, consistency. And just create a new instance. So you can, for example, create more instances of the same generator as well, if you wanted to. And then you run the method next on the generator. That's just like it is. And the return you get from it is an object, actually, an object with two properties, one being the value, the thing that you actually return, and the other one being done, which is a bool, true or false. And if we were to run it on our example above here, you notice that it actually returns as done false. You would probably expect it to be true. However, how it works is basically the first time you call next, you jump in at the very top at function and go to the first yield. And afterwards, you go continue at the yield and go to the end of the function. Even though there's nothing behind it, your code doesn't know it. So it jumps back into it, goes through. If we were to call next again, it would give us a value undefined and done true. There's a very easy way around it. You can just use return instead of yield. If you use return, it returns you the value as usually, but the done is automatically set to true. All right. So that's the very, very basic syntax of it and how it looks like. So let's look at a better example, maybe. You use generators often for iterators. That's a pretty common use case. This example, again, is you probably wouldn't do it exactly like this in practice. But just as an example, you could run a while loop forever and just yield the result every time you go through it. And then if you call next, it starts, gives you back the zero. If you call next again, it gives you back the one, and so on and so on. But the important difference is that you can pause it. You can do whatever else you want in between, which gives you a lot of power to do stuff. in between. So for example, what things you could do, maybe if you were to make a game, a classical example would be a game loop where you can jump out and do random other stuff, or lazy loading in some kind or another. Those are the kind of things you could do with that. But important to note here is that it's still Node. We are still single-threaded. It's not, as you could think, multi-threaded or anything like that. If you are aware of the event loop and how that all works, you just put it like a callback or a promise on top of this stack and go from there. So just keep that in mind. We are still Node, still single-threaded, and you still have to think about it just as much as with callbacks or promises. So you can do quite a lot of cool stuff with it, but I want to show you some more stuff that I personally use it most for in my work with APIs, which I think is pretty cool and gives you a lot of power to do stuff. So imagine if we go back to the read file thing, we could do something like so. Instead of using a callback or promise, we just yield it and then can start working with it right away. That obviously doesn't work like this because you can't use yield outside of a generator, first of all. And secondly, somehow you need to know when a read file is done and jump back into the generator and continue using it. So let's look first how that could look like. So if we had an API and we have our endpoint and we have a normal request handler, the request handler itself could be encapsulated in a generator. You'll notice a little star. It's an anonymous function, so it's just right in front of the brackets. It's indicating generator. And now we can yield the read file and return the file content and either do something with it or just return it straight to the user if we had a static website or whatever. Now, you'll notice that I added this little method called run here. I called it run, and we'll go through what it does on the next slide. However, you can essentially ignore that entirely. That is a bit that libraries can take over for you. So let's look at what this run does, because there's still something important we are missing. So as I said, you can completely ignore this. Obviously, way too much to go through now. And I'll show you later some libraries that do exactly that for you. But still, I thought it's important to at least explain the concept so you know what's happening behind the scene. And the first thing you'll notice is we just return a promise. So this whole pattern is based on promises, just as promises are based on callbacks. So essentially what happens is, on this run method, we return a promise, and we'll instance the generator, we get an instance of the generator, and then just step through it. And by step, I mean you pause it and you unpause it. So for every time you yield, it goes into the step, looks into the return object, checks whether done is true. If that's the case, then we just resolve the promise and we are done with the generator, finished. If that's not the case, we wait until the promise is resolved. So important to note here, in this example, you have to yield a promise, otherwise it doesn't work. So yield the promise and wait until the promise is resolved. As soon as it's resolved, we step back into the generator and can continue with our method. What that means is we can just use it in a really, really cool way. All the logic is now here in here. All the error handling is in here. And that allows us to write very lean and clean code. So if we have, for example, again, an API, and we have a request handler that is supposed to create a new user. It could look like so. We could, for example, ask for the check if a user with that email already exists, do our asynchronous request, and just yield for it. And we don't have to do any kind of callbacks or promises or anything. We just use the keyword yield, and then we can start using the user right away as if it were synchronous code. And we don't even have to worry about the errors at this point in time because the promise before and afterwards do that for you. So at the point here, it's really just about your logic. You look at your code, at your logic, and all the other stuff that is distracting you from the logic, from the business logic, is elsewhere. So we're asking here for the checking here if the user already has an email. If that's the case, we can just use return like we always do in every other function and everything else in this generator doesn't get executed anymore. And that's because if we use return, the done property will be set to true, and we resolve the promise right away. So you can use it just like any other method. You don't have to wrap your head around strange concepts. It works just the same, just that it allows you to use yield as well. So for example, the next step could be we want to write the user to the database. We again just use yield. We don't care about anything else. And we can use the new user straight away because technically we just jump back into the generator once it's done. But for our code, how we write it, how it looks like, it's synchronous, kind of, which is really powerful and gives you a lot of options. So in this example, we could wait now until the user has written to the database and then send out an email through a third-party provider or do it ourselves or whatever, and then just return our account is created. And I personally think that is a great thing to do. If you worry about promises, how much better they are compared to callbacks, I'm sure you'll love that because it's just even so much better. And important to note, since our run method returns a promise, we can just go on like this. So our get user by email method could be a generator as well and could make use of the yield function as well. So you can use it throughout your code base just like any other method. And you don't have to worry about anything. So you probably noted it is the same as this async await. Async await doesn't currently exist in Node, but it is in the proposed ES7 spec. So what we do now is using the cool, awesome ES6 features to simulate features that are proposed for ES7, just as we did in ES5 with the ES6 features. But we needed all the features to make it happen. Without promises, the whole pattern doesn't work. Without callbacks, promises wouldn't work. So it makes sense to go by a step-by-step through it like so. But in a year or two, hopefully, we have some natively supported as well with async await, this very exact same pattern. And it would probably look like this. The proposal at least says it should look like so. And you'll notice we have the async, which basically replaces the star to say it's a generator, and we have await, which replaces the keyword yield. Apart from that, it works the exact same way. Until then, there are obviously a lot of libraries that can help you do that, such as Babel, Co, or however I pronounce that, and other libraries by Facebook, Google, or whoever. So if you use already some kind of modernizer, then potentially you can use that pattern right away, and then you don't need to worry about this run method that does all this magic stuff because they do it for you. And they have all a little different syntax, so you have to look at the docs how exactly they do it. But the general idea is the same. And yeah, that is, in my opinion, one of the coolest things you can do with those new features, with the new generators. And I personally love it. I hope you too. And yeah, thanks. Yes.
You know the whole sort of like promises and generators, is that a way to just sort of handle the synchronous aspect of Node's API rather than to go about using the asynchronous version of all those methods?
It's about the asynchronous aspect. So it's just another way to deal with what we would have used callbacks for beforehand. So everything that is not doesn't return a value right away that needs some time, like a database call, we need to wait until it's done without blocking the process. So we use things like callbacks or promises. Yeah, and that is just a pattern to deal with that in a nice way.
Right. Thing. Is that
the
database thing a synchronous call?
No, those are all asynchronous. So all those things here, this get user by email is essentially a promise.
Okay.
So if you have this example here, this run message returns a promise. So this whole pattern is basically just a way to kind of replace the callback promise pattern to make it more nicely, If you're not aware of all the ES6 features, I use them. So I'm not sure if you're aware of the error method and how they work. But essentially, yeah, they are a function. And if you don't use the curly brackets, it's like return it automatically. If you were to use curly brackets, like, I don't know if I have it somewhere, but then you need to use the return value. But yeah, the arrows are just a nice new shorthand for that.
Thanks very much.
Thanks.